Welcome to My Art and Life. My Art and Life is hosted by the town of Oyster Bay. Our purpose is to highlight the people who vitalize the creative process demonstrated in all facets of aesthetic endeavor. We can be found on tobac.org, T-O-B-A-C.org. Today, we are very lucky and happy to have ELENI TRAGANAS. ELENI is an author, a pianist, a composer of piano works, an organist, a composer of organ works, a choir director, and she does music videos.
But who are you, sir?
I'm Lawrence Spiro, and you?
I'm Gary Piacentini. Okay.
Welcome, ELENI.
Thank you. Yes. I'm absolutely delighted to be here on this hot and sweltering summer afternoon in New York City.
I got your book, Twelfth House, and I'm using it as a guideline. In your book, you say, don't forget your roots. And then you say, Greeks love music. We Greeks like to feel things. We like it to hit us hard in our gut.
Well, you did have to select that passage now, didn't you? At random. This particular passage was written about, I believe, a festival in the backwoods areas of some provinces of Greece. Unfortunately, they have the tendency to amplify their folk music with electronics, and it just gets very loud. But they like to feel it in their gut, as they say.
Do you feel it in your gut?
Of course I feel it in my gut. That's why I'm here. But I don't amplify my music.
Okay. Is it like Zorba the Greek over there?
Yes, in many parts.
Really?
Of course, they just Oof-a. Feel. Their senses are so open and so willing to encompass everything that life has to offer. It could be the climate. I think I mentioned that briefly in the novel, too. The climate is so extreme. Mm-hmm. Hence, the people are extreme. The emotions are extreme. The temperament is extreme.
Do you speak Greek?
Of course I do.
Oh, there you go.
With my mother tongue.
I took it upon myself to get a sign, Traganus, written in Greek, and it was spelled incorrectly.
Well, at least it was recognizable, and I think that's a nifty way to greet someone at the train station.
I would like to invite everyone who's listening to go on to ElENITRAGANAS.com. That's ELENITRAGANAS.com. Follow us along as we introduce ELENI to you. We have on top of this website pianist, videos, novelist, fine artist. I have a small passage to read from your book again. Late one night after Lara finished a letter to her mother who had returned to New York, she opened the sliding door of her bedroom and stepped out onto the balcony overlooking the sea. It could have been a polar twilight, a summer evening in Russia. There was an unexpected lightness penetrating the atmosphere. Directly above, the full moon was distant and smaller than usual, faintly covered by a thin drape of gauze clouds. And in the constellation Aries, she had read that day, signifying a time of ardor and activity. You painted in words an exact detailed portrait of the sky. And in your art, when you put fine artist, every one of your works show that detail. That takes a lot of time. That takes a lot of dedication. It takes a lot of talent. Could you tell us about your artwork?
The visual art or art in general?
Visual.
For me, everything is intertwined, interrelated, I think, in terms of color. Mm-hmm. I hear in terms of color. As far as emotions are concerned, it's a matter of translating those emotions that flood our psyche into music, into words, into color. So everything is related. I can't really segregate one aspect of creativity from another. I mean, this is all intertwined, interrelated. So as a visual artist, it's a matter of rhythm and form. If you check the paintings, there's a strong rhythmic drive there too. I feel rhythm in everything, whether it be in music. And there's a natural flow, a natural...
I see like a sharpness in the paintings, right. Like extra sharpness, like high definition here.
High resolution.
High resolution,
right. Yes. But there is a type of underlying rhythm to mm-hmm. it, you know, the strokes. Everything has a direction, a purpose. And also with writing, for instance, it's not just stringing words together, but it has a contrapuntal meaning, just as composition is somehow unified with a lot of thematic material. Thematic material that's emotional, thematic material that just has a purpose that it is up to us to tie together and to create into a concrete whole. So music is contrapuntal, thread-like, a lot of themes that are completely knitted together, same with art and same with writing. So it's not just a matter of visual arts. It's just unifying everything into a whole.
You're...
Well, everything is related. You know.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
You're featured in many galleries and exhibitions. You've won many prizes for your art.
I have.
So your training had come from where?
Well, I am trained primarily as a classical musician. Juilliard, School of Performing Arts. I'm sure many of us have heard of the movie Fame and the mm-hmm. Performing Arts High School in Manhattan, which was...
You never saw kids dancing in the street, have you?
Yes. Well, that was the breeding ground for a lot of young talent. We started at the age of 13 or 14, and they offered such fantastic venues for us to pursue our interest, you know, at a very young age. So Juilliard... And School of Performing Arts, and then later on in Europe.
In Juilliard, they showed you how to mix paints and balance
colors. As I said, I'm primarily a classical musician. Painting, I had my first portfolio when I was 3. So that you can't teach painting. Can you teach music? Can you teach painting? I don't think so. You just have to have an urge to do something and to express yourself, and eventually you guide yourself.
I think the only thing you could probably teach is the guidelines, but you really can't teach.
You can't. No, you cannot. You've got to really have that sense of urgency inside of you to get that expressive message out, and you'll find a way to do it. Painting, you really can't teach painting. You can teach technical aspects of mixing paints or what to do if you're working with watercolors. I did study visual arts at Queen's College, but again, for me, painting is therapeutic. You completely lose a sense of time when you're in front of your work, your canvas or whatever. You lose time, a sense of time, and you just get immersed in something that is so...
It's personal.
But personal, it actually, it's not personal anymore. It's so universal, you just become one with the flow. Now, again, strangely enough, it's the same thing when you're performing. You become one. You lose your sense. You lose your sense of self. That's the wonderful thing about creativity. The more you do it, the more it becomes so necessary just to ride the flow and to somehow feel an intense universality around you. This mm-hmm. is what art does.
So between writing and painting and your music, there are no boundaries.
No boundaries. But again, we have to make a living. And so music has become my standby here. This is how I earn my keep.
I saw the video you did, a Papillon by Grieg, and the paintings in the background.
They're all mine. Yes, Butterfly, the Grieg lyric piece. Butterfly, right.
So you make the video too?
Yes, I do a lot of graphic design too.
There you go.
I do. Little extra income doesn't hurt.
No,
does
it doesn't.
No.
Did you do the physical work on designing that, or provided
yes,
the work?
Physical work for everything. Website too.
And you did your own website.
I did. Hey, I'm a hands-on person.
So you found a way to get 25 hours in a day.
Did I tell you? I just don't sleep.
There you go.
I'd love to, but some people just can't sleep. What can we do?
Well, when I first saw you at the Nassau County Piano Teachers Association, you played like you were three times larger than yourself. You had such power.
That must have been the Russian program. Must have been the Tchaikovsky Grand Sonata, that monster of a piece. It must have been some Scriabin works. They're very demanding. First of all, they're just physically demanding, you know. But I try to mostly concentrate on music that fits my physical dimensions. Generally, if you're 5 feet six or 5 feet seven, as a pianist, you'll have a natural affinity for someone like Chopin or Scriabin, who incidentally were both 5 feet six and a half.
But Chopin was left-handed.
He was?
Yes, he was.
Imagine that.
All the melodies in the left hand.
Oh, yes. Okay. All right.
So there you go.
Yeah.
Your critics also say that you play with a lot of power.
Power. And music is expression. Music is power. There's nothing bland about music, you know, unless you deliberately make it bland, and in which case, why listen?
You fall asleep.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. So we spoke about your playing. How about your composition? Tell us something of how you create, and tell us, you gave us a CD with some tracks. Talk about those tracks. Maybe we can start out.
Well, composition, yes, that was something that attracted me almost immediately when I first spotted a piano in my church basement. I ran to it and I started picking out melodies immediately. Now, I was about 3.5 years old or so. Mm-hmm. But a few years later, my darling, beloved canary passed away. I was very attached to this canary. And so the only way I felt that I could really honor my canary was to write a little requiem march for it. And I tried to compose. I tried and I tried. And, you know, my writing skills were very minimal. But I scratched something together, and it was a tribute to my darling bird. And it was a very simple melody. And I took great pride in it. But that was probably the first time I tried to put something on paper. And believe me, you need an infinite amount of patience to write. And
that was, a lot of patience, yeah.
That was a very young age. How about now? And we have from an ode to a canary to a piece played by the Israeli Sinfonietta.
Oh, yes. The cadenzas to this. This is the Mozart Concerto in D minor, K-466, one of two concerti that Mozart composed. Mm-hmm. In a minor key, and I wrote the cadenzas to this concerto, which were published and dedicated to my mentor, the Viennese Mozart specialist, Paul Badura Skoda, who apparently held them in high esteem.
What color is D minor to you?
To me?
Brown?
No. It is a very strong, unmistakable gold color, very gold, jeweled. In a way, it has that strong sense of association to a jeweled, dark golden hue.
Beautiful.
So we're going to listen to the climax of the first movement, the Allegro, and we will start just before the cadenza.
Thank you.
listening to Eleni Traganas, a wonderful pianist, and we are at My Art and Life. We're in WCWP.88.1 FM. We'll be right back, too. Keep going, Julian.
Welcome back to My Art and Life. We are with Eleni Traganas, and we are having the joy of listening to her cadenzas for Allegro from Mozart's Concerto in D minor. Without any hesitation, we would like you to hear this cadenza, which we'll play for you now.
Say, what a joy. Excellent, excellent work there.
Thank you.
This was in Israel, right?
No, this was with the Israel Sinfonietta.
In Athens, I'm sorry.
Yes, in Athens, yeah. Yes. With, by the way, this is an EMI recording, EMI classics.
I tell you, I wish I had a video camera right now, watching you conduct yourself while listening to the music. It's priceless.
Oh, thank you. I do conduct. Of course, I have my own choirs, as we know. So conducting, it's in your blood. It's in the rhythm. You feel it. You have to make these gestures. And besides, Greeks make hand gestures. We all know that.
I see that. Yeah. So do Italians. My
That's
God.
That's right. Hey, as they say in Greek, mia fazza, mia razza.
Oh, which means?
One face, one race.
Oh, my God. Oh. I got a question, though. Do you have a favorite piano that you like to play on?
The Bluthner.
The Bluthner.
Bluthner.
Bluthner. Bluthner.
It's a German piano from Leipzig.
As opposed to a Steinway or Baldwin.
Oh, I love Steinways. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I'm sure a lot of Steinway pianists are out there hearing this.
It's one.
Okay. Bluthner, German instrument from Leipzig, played on and appreciated by Franz Liszt, amongst others. Very popular instrument back in Europe. And I am fortunate to have one. Unfortunately, though, it needs a major renovation, and that is not an inexpensive job. It is going to be
very expensive.
Very, very costly.
Yeah, they have the separate overtone string.
That's the Alico system. For some of the concert grands. Yes, that extra fourth system, that string that brings out the harmonics for a bigger, richer tone. Unfortunately, I don't have that on my instrument. But I've played on some...
Was that the piano you played on?
No, that was a Steinway.
Steinway.
Yes. Steinway, nice say job. They have the overtones built in their design.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So the that particular piece was played once. Have you conducted it and performed it elsewhere?
No. I move on.
You move
as
on.
As we discussed.
Like the book.
Yes. I do something and I move on to the next project.
And what is the next project that we have on your list?
Composition. We are going to hear a magnificent organ from St. Patrick's Cathedral in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. This was from their Concert of Marian Music just a couple of weeks ago. And I was honored that they chose my music to perform. These are the odes to the Theotokos. Theotokos from New Testament Greek meaning Mother of God. So this was in honor of Mary, Marian music. And this is the first piece that we're going to be listening to with Dr. Jennifer Pasquale directing and Michael Hay at the organ and St. Patrick's Cathedral Choir.
Bravo.
Wonderful harmonies.
Thank you.
Yes. That organ I've seen the organ. It has hundreds of stops and
five manual Kilgan. Yes,
five
huge.
Manuals, a full complement of pedals. How did you learn to master that?
This was Michael Hay performing.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
I am just the composer. Hey, I just wrote the music here. I have my own organ in my church, my congregation in the Bronx, and I'm also involved with several other churches. Mm-hmm. So various...
Three manuals, right?
Three manual. This is a five manual.
You never see a fat organist, I tell you that. I mean, you got the...
They're dancing. Their feet are flying.
You want to lose weight, you play a little Bach there. You got to use the pedal. You use 20 pounds after playing it.
That's right. You're constantly in motion. And it's really very challenging. But it's an entirely different system altogether. Playing the piano, you press the sustaining pedal, and your tones are sustained. But with the piano, it's all about muscle power. If you're a skinny little person and you don't know how to use your muscles, you're not going to produce a sound.
Yeah.
Whereas at the organ, all you have to do is just pull out a stop. And before you know it, the whole house is exploding with power. So it's you're in control. Exactly. Yes. You just know. You have to know how to manipulate the stops.
It's like being a pilot on an airplane, right?
Right. Yes. Very true.
Chopin wasn't very large.
He was 5 feet six. He was
Chopinetto. They called him 140 pounds.
No, he was much less.
Less than
around 110 pounds at the most. Very skinny little guy.
But what power came out of his
music? Well, the power, actually, he didn't have much physical power. But what he did was have emotional power, and that shows through his playing. He couldn't really project across the concert hall. A lot of people were complaining that they couldn't hear him. But they were mesmerized by his presence and by the contrasts in his playing. So that
his Polonaise. He was almost considered to be patriotic to the Polish cause.
Of course.
At that time. I don't think he was, though. But
of course, he was patriotic to the Polish cause.
Oh,
his whole heart was in Poland. Literally. They moved it to Poland at his death.
Right.
Yes.
They did, yes. Mm. You've played just about every work, every type of work he's written.
I have, yes.
What's your favorite?
I had a natural voice, had a natural affinity for Chopin, as most pianists do, if they're romantically inclined as pianists. It just fits the hands so beautifully. It's absolutely perfect. So, yes, I was a Chopin enthusiast from an early age. Chopin, Mozart, and Bach. Now, Chopin, I think we know, really held Bach and Mozart in the highest esteem. So these were his great mentors, so to speak. He had very little esteem or nominal esteem for the other composers. Mm-hmm. Liszt, of course, not very much at all.
Well, he was contemporary anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Beethoven,
I saw the movie.
Not so much. Which movie?
Song to Remember.
Oh, that was great. With Cornell Wilde?
Cornell Wilde, yes.
What a great movie. I grew up with that movie. There was a time
years
ago. Jose
Turby played the piano.
Yeah, he was great.
Yes, he was great. Yeah.
He was great. I remember when I was a kid, they were airing that on Million Dollar Movie.
Yeah. Every
remember
night.
That? Every night I would sneak into the living room to turn on the TV in the middle of the night because they would replay it from 1 o'clock and then 3 o'clock and 5. I remember spending every night for the whole week that they were airing that movie, and I would stay up all night watching every single rerun of that particular movie, and I was exhausted at the end of the week.
It was in black and white.
Black and white
TV at that time, but it was in color,
the
movie.
It's been colorized in the meantime.
Yeah.
Of course, it has nothing to do with facts or reality.
No, I don't think he wrote the revolutionary
fictionalized
etude and then spit blood from tuberculosis
the keys, right?
on the piano.
Yes.
But.
It makes for a great Hollywood showmanship, though, but that's not the real story.
You do respect, though, the actors who fake the piano. I was wondering, you know, looking at them playing it, whether or not they're playing the right keys or not. I mean, they were taught, but they weren't playing. You know, there was somebody was playing it. Like Jose Turby was playing for Cornell
Wilde. But sometimes it's so patently obvious, it's painful to look at.
Yeah.
If you know what you're doing.
Who played Clara Schumann?
Catherine Hepburn.
Catherine Hepburn, yes.
Oh, I remember that film.
Great actress, but
it was not in sync, I'm sorry to say.
Historically, it was really off.
Yeah.
But she really mimed the piano playing very well.
Yeah.
from what I saw. David Duval said that isn't a day that goes by where someone doesn't fall in love with Chopin. And that's absolutely true. So now we have track three.
Track
three.
And you're
going to speak more.
Nikolai Medtner.
About your playing.
A contemporary of Alexander Scriabin. And it's the big year. Scriabin's 100th anniversary of his untimely passing. April of 1915, just as the First World War was breaking out in Europe.
Right.
He broke out in a boil on his lip and died a few weeks later from an infection.
Oh, my God.
At the young and tender age of 43, just while he was at the height of his powers. So Nikolai Medtner was his contemporary. He was born a few years later, 1880. But his music basically takes off, in a sense, where Scriabin's began. It's highly complicated, a little more accessible in a way than Scriabin's, but also very Russian in its lugubrious and grim outlook. It is so depressing, very dark and forbidding, as you will shortly see, but also
just
very
like old fairy tales. Grim.
Yeah, they are. Yes, you know. Touché. Right. Touché, Gary.
All right.
So this is the Nikolai Medtner fairy tale.
Bravo. Mm-hmm. You played that memorized?
Of course.
You have perfect
I have a
photographic memory.
Well, yes, to some extent, of course. I can't play with music. Somehow I find it very difficult. I like to lose myself in the actual conception of a piece, and when you have music in front of you on a stand, you're drawn back down to earth again, and it's just it's a barrier between you and a higher, elevated sense of self somehow. So I try and avoid using music as much as possible.
Right. Well, we're going to get back to that, and we are going to return to you in the next segment here. We are at My Art and Life, and we're on WCWP 88.1 FM. Larry?
I'm Lawrence Spiro.
Gary? I'm Gary Piacentini.
Yes.
Eleni?
And this is Elena Traganas.
There you go.
Welcome back to My Art and Life. We are with Eleni Traganas, and I would like to read for you a short bio. Eleni Traganas, who was born in New York City, holds degrees from the Juilliard School and has studied in conservatories in Germany and Switzerland. Her works have appeared in numerous literary journals, and her varied activities as performer, composer, and visual artist have earned her listings in Who's Who in America and accolades from the international press. So various activities are described as your work. And,
well, this is the part of the blurb you were reading from the novel, so you want to tailor your biography to suit the audience. In this case, it's a literary audience, you know.
Yes, we read portions of your book, and we heard portions of your composition. We were talking off the air about composers. Do you have a favorite composer?
I do, and it is none other than Bach himself. Bach, who never ceases to amaze. Bach is just truly divine in every sense, from his just from the focal point of his output itself is staggering. The absolute perfection of his contrapuntal writing. There's always something to learn from Bach. It is as virtually perfect as you will find any music.
Yeah,
today.
Is it not true though? But he was not known during his time as a composer, but more of just an organist. So
he was absolutely a phenomenal organist. Yes, he was famed far and wide for his organ playing. But fortunately, he left for us a massive legacy, and it is something that teaches us, or at least teaches me, every day. I start my day with Bach.
I looked at the production of the Beatles, Bach, Beethoven, and Mozart in current availability of CDs. The Beatles have 10 CDs that you could buy, which embodies all their work. Beethoven has a little shy of 100 CDs that embodies all his work. Mozart has approximately 180 CDs, which comprise his work. And Bach, they have close to 300 CDs with everything he's produced, and they claim that half of it is lost.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. Well, he had 19 kids, you know. Every time he came home, he said, who's new?
It's staggering. The output is just phenomenal. Staggering music.
What part?
He also had two wives, too, I think.
Yes.
And his second wife, Anna Magdalena, actually wrote the first lessons in Bach.
That she was his copyist.
Right. So some of them are assuming that she wrote the pieces.
His incentives, Beethoven sensed the different parts of a work and then brought them together. Mozart saw the entire piece at one time and wrote it down.
Mm-hmm.
And Bach worked for the glory of God and also not to be thrown in jail, because every week he had to produce a canto. So he had to produce a mammoth amount of music, and which he did.
A cantata a week, yes, that keeps you on your toes.
Well, I would think so.
It's amazing, too. He had his sons working the pumps in the back. What do you call them? And the organ? They were actually pressing the air while he was playing the keyboard. The bellows, that's it. I don't know these things. What do I know? I just played the keyboard, that's it.
So we're going to hear some Clementi now. Yes?
Yes, the Clementi Sonata in F-sharp minor.
A
favorite of Vladimir Horowitz, by the way.
Yes, and Scriabin as well.
No, Scriabin, of course, was Horowitz's forte.
When did Clementi write his music? What era?
Well, he was a contemporary of Mozart and early Beethoven. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about the 1790s.
Mm-hmm. And the approach you have in this sonata, which is F minor, and what color is that?
This is not F minor. This is F sharp minor.
Oh, F sharp. I'm sorry.
Yes, big difference.
I missed the little tic tac toe song.
We're blowing it today, Larry.
I know. That's why you're here, Gary.
Now, as far as Scriabin was concerned, and his color chart, and F sharp had a very different color connotation than Rimsky-Korsakov. I can ask you, Larry, what do you associate the key of F sharp with? What color comes to mind when you think of F sharp?
Yellow.
Really?
Yes.
Is that a random choice?
No.
So when you're at the keyboard playing something in F-sharp minor, you think of yellow?
Yes.
When you're playing it key of F major, what do you think of?
Key of F major would be more like, it would be like a rose color.
Rose.
Rose.
Okay.
See how highly subjective this is. But there seems to be a general consensus. The key of F sharp for most pianists, and there are exceptions, Larry, for most pianists resonates to a dark indigo blue color.
Yeah, I was thinking of a dark color myself. Exactly. I usually think of a major, like a bright color, mm-hmm. F sharp, but I prefer G flat myself.
Difference there.
Yeah.
G-flat is not a blue color in my sense. Mm-hmm. G-flat is more like a dark maroon-brown color. But then again, this is purely subjective, but it opens our minds to the kind of color synesthesia that's out there and attaching color combinations to our emotions, too, and tying everything together. It's very important. But all right, we're going to be listening to Muzio Clementi's Sonata in F-sharp minor. That's Opus 26, number 1, and that is the
number
first
two.
Movement. Opus 26, number 2, first movement. And this was produced by WDR Westdeutsche Rundfunk, Cologne Studios. Thank you.
Your trills were crisp. Your ascension up the keyboard with octaves and the virtuosity in your right
I'm all ears, Larry. Let me hear some more.
And what kind of piano was that?
That was a Steinway Hamburg. And it was not a Bösendorfer, not a Blüthner with the umlaut, not a Bechstein.
And you were mentioning during the break, during the music episode, that you were you had carte blanche to all the pianos
yes,
in the
I
studio.
Did. Yes, yes.
Did they really have 1,000 to choose from? Or?
Who said 1,000?
Wow.
No, quite
many.
A few. Many. A multitude.
Didn't they have a 9-foot Blüthner?
No, I didn't see a Blüthner. Believe me, I would have run to that Blüthner. We have coming up the Chopin Polonaise in C-sharp minor, Opus 26, number 1. And that was recorded at St. Peter's Church in Manhattan at Citigroup Center, live in recital.
Excellent. That was live, right?
That was live at St. Peter's Church in Manhattan. They have a Baldwin.
I was going to ask you.
Yes, I know. I saw it coming.
The reason why I asked, because I remember seeing Andre Watts playing the piano at the Nassau Community College. Actually, I was sketching him at the time, and I didn't know what kind of piano it was. So I figured that it was a Steinway. So I wanted him to sign the picture, right? Right. And he goes, I don't sign. That's not a, I do Baldwin myself.
Uh-huh.
That's, got to change it to the Baldwin, right?
Right.
True story.
I believe it.
Yeah.
Well, there were any instrument, Baldwin, Steinway, Blüthner, Bechstein, Yamaha.
Well said, Larry.
It's what you put in it. It's how you play it.
It's the feeling behind it.
It's the feeling behind it.
That's true, but you want an instrument that stands beside you and interprets your feelings to the best of your ability so that you can put your best foot forward. If you have an instrument that you're struggling with, mm-hmm. it makes it all the more hard and difficult and a challenge to get your message.
Do you like a lighter touch on the piano or a heavy touch?
Well, somehow a very heavy touch gets very stodgy and very difficult to wade through, like wading through mud. You mm-hmm. want just the right touch with mm-hmm. a nice dip in the end so that you can just get your fingers in the keys and project the way you want to.
We now have last, excuse me, we'll be celebrating the centennial of Scriabin this year. And
well, we're not really celebrating the centennial of someone's death, do we? We observe it.
No, actually.
We celebrate the anniversary of someone's passing.
Well, actually, it makes a lot of sense because I remember listening to WQXR when it was owned by the New York Times, right? Yes, and they said, why do we celebrate the person's birth? They don't do anything when they're born. It's when they made their living, when they lived, we celebrate their death because
right.
what they did during their lifetime.
Right, a compendium of their life's work.
So it makes a lot of sense.
I celebrate Scriabin's work and the performers that played his work, such as Horowitz and you. So we have now a sonata.
That is the Sonata number 6, Opus 62, one of his groundbreaking works, which was a major change from the fifth sonata, which had that saccharine sweet element to it. And this changes into a dramatic shift in his compositional style. And he's taking on here to the heights that were to lead him to unknown terrain very soon. So this is one of his groundbreaking later works. Also produced by Westdeutsche Rundfunk in Cologne.
Great show, I tell you, and this has been My Art and Life with Gary Piacentini and Larry...
Lawrence Spiro.
Okay, and...
And Elena Traganas.
But you can call me Larry.
Okay. And we got Julian at the desk over here. What a tremendous show. Thank you very much.
Thank you for inviting me. It was an absolute pleasure to be here today.